When the civil war in Somalia began, Abdi Nor Iftin was 5. He attended a madrasa while providing for his family. Amidst the daily shelling and the famine, Abdi had one escape: American movies and music. He learned of America and taught himself English and began to dream of a life in the United States. In his memoir titled Call Me American, Abdi recounts his harrowing, extraordinary, and uplifting story. His love of Western culture and music earned him the name Abdi American. This became a liability when Islamic extremism took hold of Somalia. Evading conscription by al-Shabaab while secretly filing stories for NPR under penalty of death, he stayed in Somalia until he had no choice but to flee to Kenya. And then a stroke of incredible luck, he won the diversity visa lottery. Now a proud and legal resident of Maine and on the path to citizenship this year, Abdi will become one of us. So one last business to take care of as we leave. We're going to leave out what's the left-hand side if you look behind you, so that those entering through the next will come on the right. Downstairs, Yankee Bookshop has set up a place for you to purchase Abdi's memoir, and there'll be a book signing after the talk. Please welcome Abdi Nor Iftin.
Has anybody heard my story on This American Life? Abdi and the Golden Ticket? Oh. That was moving, wasn't it? It was just a small part of my story, especially the complicated part of coming to the United States, even after winning the lottery. So even though I won that lottery, I still faced the American, I would say, unfortunately, the government's bias and prejudice towards immigrants and refugees and Muslims and Somalis and all that. So I was not that young man, at least to the American government at the time. I was not the young man who was nicknamed Abdi the American, the one who had really fought hard to go to movie theaters, even if it was against our culture. While you were studying madrasa, even if I had been punished and hanged one a whole night by the madrasa teacher because I went and watched Arnold Schwarzenegger's Terminator. And because it was a distraction from the right path, the good way of learning the Quran. My mother kicked me out of the house, the madrasa teacher hanged me, beat me, you know, I faced all these challenge, and I realized it was unacceptable and sort of like a betrayal to my American dream that day when I realized I had to fight hard for my visa in 2014. It's quite a story. I would recommend if you go and Google Abdi and the Golden Ticket, it comes out, and without really, and I think it had become one of the most listened podcasts in the United States. So this radio program was on before I published my memoir. So to go to my memoir, I am going to read you a part of my book. And this part that I chose to read to you is that moment when life had begun to come together. I grew up in Mogadishu, Somalia. When I was 5 years old, the civil war begins and we lost everything. Our house and our father walked away from us. And I watched him, when I was five, disappear into the woods. And the years that followed, we were orphans. Everybody called us orphans because in Mogadishu, it had become the city of women and children. Having a father was quite a surprise. And you were so lucky that both of your parents were alive. So this way, automatically, without even knowing if my father had died, we had become the orphans, and I had accepted that because that was the truth and the reality that at the time existed. But we never had a permanent place. Up until now, as I speak to you, we don't have our house. So my mother can live anywhere that she prefers. A week ago, she moved from one place. Today, she's in a certain area, and she keeps moving around. While I am here in Vermont, and I have a permanent place here in the United States, I live in Maine. So part of me is still out there. It connects with me. So I just want to read you this story that happened one day in 2008, when Somalia has become an Islamic state, and I was caught up in this limbo where there were only two choices, to join the army or to leave. So joining the army was not an option for me. Leaving was an option. And what were the best ways to get out of Somalia? For those of you who know where Somalia is, Somalia has the second largest coastline in Africa, after Madagascar. So we have a border with Kenya and Ethiopia and Djibouti, and they have closed their borders. So no one was able to really cross on the other side. I tried it. It wouldn't work out for me. The Somali pirates, for those of you who had watched a movie Hollywood has made called Captain Phillips, so the Somali pirates were making money by putting us on boats and crossing across the Gulf of Aden into Yemen. And the money that you needed to have for this journey was $80. Several months, I did everything. And I was able to only collect $45. And I tried to buy the ticket to that boat that crosses across the Gulf of Aden, goes into Yemen. Unfortunately, they wouldn't let me ride that boat because I had way less money than they wanted. And in fact, the journey crossing the Gulf of Aden to Yemen, which so many young Somalis were doing at the time, was 50-50. It's a sailing boat, and it's overcrowded. Most of these boats have actually not made it. Hundreds of people died. You wouldn't have seen this on CNN or NPR. The world didn't pay much attention to Somalia. And I had several friends. Some had made it, some had not. And I have mentioned those friends in this book. So now, I didn't have the money to go on a boat and leave from Somalia to somewhere else. My options were shrinking and my life had no meaning at all. And then one day, I was walking around bare feet, homeless. I couldn't find my mother, I couldn't find my sister. And my nieces and my nephews and my sister were separated. The city had become a total chaos. It had been flattened to the ground more than Aleppo, Syria, as you can imagine. And out of a sudden, there was the magic of my life that had appeared. It was an American journalist, and his name was Paul Salopek. So Paul and I want to read you this before I go deep into what happened. One day, I was walking through town, hopping over smoking rubble from a fresh shelling, when I heard the click and whir of a motorized camera from a building across the street. Cameras were not normal sounds in Mogadishu. Up on the balcony of a guest house was an Asian photographer and a white man. They disappeared into the walls of the guest house. But I stood there, watching and waiting. Finally, they reappeared. The white guy waved, I waved back. Then his bodyguards, some hired Somali militiamen at the gate of the house, thought I was making trouble for them. They pointed their AK-47 at my head. "Go away," said one. "Leave now." The white guy was still watching from above. I was so afraid I could be shot. But I summoned all my courage and yelled up at the white guy. "I want to talk to you," I said in my best English. The man disappeared inside. The militiamen were getting angrier, shaking their guns. "You can't communicate with a white man," one said. "You stupid man," said another. "Leave." "He's okay. Let him come," the voice from the courtyard said. It was a white man, now at the gate. His guards didn't understand his words, but of course I was the movie translator of Mogadishu. He says, let me meet him. I told the guards in Somali. They thought I was tricking them. What 22-year-old Somali man could speak English? And after all, they were getting paid to protect this guy. But the white man used hand gestures to let them know it was okay. They searched me thoroughly before I walked into the building. Finally, Paul Salopek and I shook hands. Hi, I said. It's good to meet you, sir. I'm very excited. When he heard me speak English, his eyebrows went up. Whoa, come on up, man. What do you drink, hot or cold? Paul asked. We were on his balcony. He had a Pepsi in one hand, and a kettle of tea was on the table. I never had Pepsi in my whole life. I only saw it in the movies. That one, I said, pointing to the Pepsi. What's your name? My name's Abdi. Abdi, are you from this area? Yes, I live down that road towards the big tree over there. I pointed in the direction of our house. I took a sip of a Pepsi. I had never tasted anything so delicious in my life. Whoa, I like this, I told Paul. He brought out two more cans of Pepsi for me to take home. But I finished them all on the spot. Paul asked me a lot of questions about life in Mogadishu, and I told him my story up on that balcony as we looked down on the ruined city. He and Kuni, his Japanese-born photographer, were surprised that I had learned English just from watching movies. I told them there were no movies in Mogadishu anymore. I said most of the guys my age had been recruited by the Islamists, and I felt my luck was running out. It sucks to be here, man, I said using my best Hollywood slang. Then I started bombarding Paul with questions about America. I asked him about New York, California, the cars, the food, what snow's like. He could not restrain me. Paul soon realized how much I loved America, and he said something that gave me hope. Abdi, I'm sure that one day you will live in America. We spoke for 3 hours. When I left, Paul handed me his business card. Then he reached into his pocket and pulled out $50. Abdi, I'm sure that one day you will live in America. Here, buy a cell phone so I can call you. What's left, give to your family. By now, cheap cell phones were becoming widely available in Somalia. And for a few dollars, you could buy scratch cards from a kiosk that gave you enough money to talk family member abroad. For even less money, you could send text messages if you knew how to write. Every few days, you would need to pay someone with a generator, like a cyber cafe, to recharge your phone because no one had electricity. We hacked and waved goodbye. Abdi, said Paul from the gate, make sure you email me your phone number. So, I mean, as you can see, this was the first time in my whole life since I learned English by watching American films. It took me about 7 years to learn English. It's the exact time it took me to memorize and learn every single verse in the Quran. For those of you who know what the Quran is the Islamic book written by human beings, but it came from God, sent through Muhammad, and word by word it's been written, and it goes one after the other. And the process of studying Quran, I have documented in my memoir, especially in Somalia. It's nothing that an American parent would ever accept. Nothing. Well, it involves beating and torture. Somehow, your skin cracks open and blood comes out, and that's actually not a bad thing. As it's part of the process of teaching, where when I came home at the age of 7 or 8 or 9, and my mother would see that I have blood on my skin and that I have bruises on my face, she wouldn't be worried. She would be fine. Because she knows that this is from the angel of punishment. So the angel of punishment is a nickname that I gave to the madrasa teacher, and it's in the book. I call him angel of punishment because of that punishment that happened. So what's the whole purpose? You memorize over 6,000 verses from the Quran, one after the other. You become fluent, you memorize everything, and the goal of this, well, first of all, is that this will save you in the afterlife. You die, you get quizzed in the grave, you're gonna get asked a few questions related to the Quran, and you pass and you move on. And so for that to be in your brain, that's a good thing, that's an advantage. So if I died during the punishment in those years, it wouldn't worry my mother, it wouldn't worry anybody. It would take 5 minutes to dig up some dirt out of the ground. I could go in there. Period. This Abdi who's here, who published a memoir, would never exist. So I made it. I made it through. I graduated. And then the moment I graduated, my mom would ask me, you know what, now you can become your own madrasa teacher. And I said, I'm not interested. I don't want to beat anybody. I just want my own life. This is the 90s. And I would say late 90s, in fact. The US Marines came to Mogadishu, they got into a war with Somali militias, they pulled out. But now America had spread all over the world through its music and movies. Michael Jackson was known in Somalia more than anybody else. Madonna was famous. Eddie Murphy and Bruce Willis and Arnold Schwarzenegger were like, they were Somali, except that they had a white skin. Almost everyone knew. But who knew it? The people the age of my mother, the grown-up people, thought that those were the devil people. Well, because they're not Muslims. But for those of us, the Civil War generation, who grew up confused and wondering what life is like. Should I focus on the life here, or should I focus on the life after? And unlike American children, there was no playground or anything fun to do. So luckily, the movie existed and soccer existed. So those were the two biggest entertainments that we occupied ourselves with, especially after graduating from the madrasa, and when I realized now I'm free, I can do anything. So I focused more on the movies. And word by word, watching all these action movies, several hundreds of times, the Terminators, the Rambos, and the Commandos, I memorized every single thing that happens in the movies. And then I memorized every single thing that they have said. And now I became an interpreter. I would sit in the movie, and a new film comes, and everyone is looking at me, and the movie begins, and I would tell everyone what was happening. I would say, oh, he says he loves that woman. And now they go ahead and kiss. And he says, oh, he's going to kill this guy. And it happens. And he says, oh, he'll be back. And Arnold Schwarzenegger says, I'll be back. And now I got encouragement. It was like several dozen young children of my age sitting around in the movie theater and going everywhere and saying, that guy is American. So I became the American without even being in America. So they gave me this nickname. I did not know what America really meant. It came to me as an idea. It did not come to me as a country. For instance, if you called me a Kenyan, to me, Kenya is a country, it's a nation, right? But somehow, my Americanization process began right there, sitting in that movie theater, with all these kids now starting to call me America, and I didn't really think America as a country anymore. I thought, well, you know, it could be like Abdi happy, Abdi love, Abdi appreciation. It became like an adjective or something that can define somebody. So that's how America begins to me. And sort of I grew up really loving and wanting that America, and I fought hard with my mother. Because even though Somalia is a colonial to the Italians and the English, and for those of you who know, Africa had been predominantly colonized by French and England. But those two countries didn't have any presence or any movement in Somalia. Nobody called themselves the Englishman or the Frenchman. And in fact, when Somalia's currency was wiped out by the Civil War, now the US dollar becomes the currency of Somalia. Now I see the presidents on the US dollar. I didn't receive any money from the US, but because of the Civil War, America had brought in refugees from Somalia in 91. So by 1999, Somalia had received, I would say, millions of dollars from family members who had been resettled by the United States into this country, and they started working and started sending money back home. And now we were emerging out of the Civil War, and we did not have a government. So somehow we had some money sent by family members. People were starting to build some life, roof over their heads, food and clothes. And now people had started bringing in studios where they played American music out loud. So literally Mogadishu had become America. But then unfortunately, some American president made a mistake and attacked Iraq and Afghanistan. And now, as you know, that was the purpose. These Islamists really enjoyed that attack because they recruited more people and Somalia was a no man's land, there was no government. Now they came in and started bombing the movie theater, and movie theater was gone. And with loudspeakers and written notes, they have told us to stop speaking English, not to have a girlfriend. Women must be separated from men in the bus. No music. If they find you with a picture of Madonna, they're going to cut your head. You cannot play soccer. All soccer fields were turned into a punishment field where people who made mistakes could be brought over and they cut their hands and all that. Within a few weeks, my whole dream, my whole life sort of vanished in front of my eyes. And I've received a phone call after I met Paul Solpek, and that phone call was an Islamist on the other side. He said, "Did they really call you American?" I said, "Yes, I am Abdi the American." And he said, "Well, we're going to kill you for that." And now my life had directly been threatened. They found out who I was, and I went into hiding. So people who reviewed my book, people who read my book, have, you know, called it enlightening. It gave them hope, because if you ever complain of anything, I do sometimes, you know, we live in America and we take things for granted. When we have some storms in Maine and there's no electricity for one night, I just go up and down and go crazy and I'm like, who am I? I have lived my whole life without a house, without electricity, what am I talking about? You know, or when we go on Twitter and we see something and we just so frowned because we're driven by the politics today and all that, you know, or when you go open the fridge and there's no milk and you're like, am I supposed to drive to the grocery store now? And you are angry. It helps me a lot. And some people said, for you telling your story, isn't that digging up the wound? Doesn't it hurt? Because you're going back to these memories in the past where you almost died, where you were threatened. What about your country? Does that really give you any? Yes, it is relieving. You know, looking back on my past, and now realizing that I'm breathing, I can see, I haven't really been physically injured, I went through all of this. I was meant to be here. I would love to say that for any other, most of the refugees and immigrants here in the United States, either in Vermont or in Maine or in Boston, just look around. They have come here through the refugee process, meaning took them about between 5 to 10 years, because that's how long it takes for the refugee process, the screening, everything else. I have a brother who came to Kenya 2004. Up until now, 2019, he has still been waiting to be resettled to the United States. Only 2 years ago, after this election, he was sent a letter that gave him a heart attack. He was permanently denied coming to the United States. So he was devastated. But I came to Kenya, joined my brother in 2011, and I registered my name as a refugee, so I was an asylum seeker in Kenya. But then I was hoping that America would resettle me, and the officer said, let's say 25 years, that's how long it will take for you. And I was so shocked. And I realized, well, you know what? America is not the place that I was made to go. And seriously, I was hoping to collect and gather some money, $5,000, $6,000, leave from Kenya to Sudan. And there's the Sahara Desert. For those of you who know, the Sahara Desert is fatal. Many people don't make through that. But I was hoping to cross that desert, get into Libya, because there was an opportunity, and up until now it's still happening, where you can get on a boat from Libya, cross the Mediterranean, and you go to Sicily or somewhere in Italy. And then once you get into Europe, they take your fingerprints and they put you in a camp. And that's what my friends have done, and they are there. And I was hoping that. And again, I was waiting for the money, and I couldn't receive the money when I was in Kenya. Then one day, I was sitting with my friends, we're having a tea somewhere in Nairobi. Refugees gather, and we talk, and we have conversations, we eat together. And I looked across the street, and I realized there was a cyber cafe, because people don't have Wi-Fis in the houses. So there was a cyber cafe, and cyber cafes have internet, where you can go and you can rent the computer, and you use it, and send email or whatever. And your time runs out, you leave. I noticed that this person was advertising a lottery program that you can apply, you could come to the United States. 2017, which is 2 years ago, 20 million people applied to this lottery program to come to the United States. 20 million people. Who are these 20 million people? Canada, United Kingdom, they're from all continents. Even if you live in the US as a student, if you're not permanently living in the US, you're allowed to apply for that lottery. And if you win, you can permanently live here. So this program, refugees and immigrants and, you know, asylum seekers and all that, they have their eyes on this program. Before I won this lottery, many people thought the chances of winning this is not even anywhere near. So the chance is 1 in 600. I became that one in 2014. Yes. And I couldn't believe it. I called my brother and I said, my name comes up and it says you're selected. And we worked together to figure out what the next process was. So that's where it goes to This American Life episode about my story. That's where it documented. What we did was, even though I won the lottery, I was hoping America to open its doors and say, well, you're lucky, you won the lottery, let's just do a screening and let's check your name if you're associated with terrorism, and let's figure that out within 3 months and everything will happen okay. Took me a year. I haven't heard anything from them. They kept my case. They were hoping to sort of, you know, sort of expire the visa, because the lottery expires in every September. In every September. And it was only July when we pushed so hard that my visa has been issued. It's been quite a headache. And it was a time when Kenya government was deporting Somalis back to their countries, and my brother and I went into hiding in a tiny apartment for 3 months. 3 months, we couldn't even get to the grocery store. So we were really sort of being starved, almost to death, and my brother hates this, and he especially hates it when he's an older brother, and he wants to be in charge and sort of become the one who advises him. He advised me and he said, Abdi, give up on this American dream. Let's go to Somalia. And I told him, it's a suicide. Because me going back to Somalia, they're going to kill me the next day. They don't know you. You left before these guys have arrived. And he said, at least it's better for you to die in Somalia than here. Because the Kenyan government may not deport you. They might get you and kill you and bury you, and no one will figure out, because Somalia doesn't have a government that checks on its citizens. If you're an American, if you disappear somewhere, probably the United States government will have to push that government, and something has to happen to find out where you are, because you're an American citizen. There's nothing called Somali citizen, unfortunately. I'm not in the system. My birthday is not recorded in Somalia. My name's not recorded in Somalia. I only speak Somali. If you learn Somali, you could be a Somali if you have a dark skin. So there was nobody that would advocate for us. And I said, Well, I don't want to go back. I will fight to the last to get my to make my dream come true, to get to the United States. With intervention and support from 25 American citizens, including professors who teach at the University of Manchester, who are the family that adopted me into Yarmouth, they have pushed so hard, sent letters to the US government, and that way, my visa has been issued. Well, I land in Boston, so excited. I was looking forward to the Las Vegas, Manhattan lifestyle. The Arnold Schwarzenegger life, you know, the police chasing thugs. Like, I was expecting chaos in America. I was also expecting skyscrapers, things to be extremely amazing and glittering, you know, things like that. But I don't know if you guys ever go to Maine, but driving on 95 from Boston to Maine, midnight, you only see the lights of other cars coming this way. There are no buildings, there are tall trees. And I asked Sharon, who's the mother who sort of adopted me into their house, I asked her, I said, where are we going? Where is America? And she was like, oh, it makes sense. The America that you know from the movies is not here. We're taking you to a small town, farm. You're gonna see horses, you're gonna see goats, chickens, and all that. And I said, you have horses? You have goats? What? So I went into this farmhouse in Yarmouth. The street that goes in front of the house is quiet. Every 5 minutes, there's one car that goes that way, 35 miles an hour. Another car that goes this way. And the Mainers are very friendly. They wave. They smile. We, in Africa, nobody ever waves and smiles to you. So somehow I was so confused. Every time I ran back to the house, even though I was 29 years old, asking this McDonald family millions of questions, I said, why are the people, you know, smiling at me? What's going on? Said, oh, we're friendly. If they wave, wave back. If they smile, smile back. Well, that's your choice, but people are here are friendly. I said, okay. And then they were going to camping. The McDonald family were putting things in the back of the truck. And here I was, just 1 week in town, still so confused. I'm like, why are your chickens bigger than the chickens that we have in Africa? Why are your horses so giant? You know, why is the mailbox on the other side of the street? Aren't people stealing it? You know, all these questions. And they were like, well, Abdi, we're going to get away from you. You're too much. They were going camping, and I said, so what's camping? So they talked about building a tent, building a fire, reading books, before it gets cold, of course. I said, you're really describing a refugee life. I'm not interested in going to camping. Well, especially when you have this giant, beautiful house that has 8 rooms, several bathrooms, there's a basement, it smells nice, it's pretty clean, you know, there's two living rooms, and I'm like, who in the world would get away from this house when we are dying to find a place like this? And then you guys are just taking, what, a week exposing yourselves to the mosquitoes and crocodiles? Well, there's no crocodile in Maine, but that's what was in my mind. And I had to call my brother and give him an update and everything. I'm like, they left me all in this house. And now they're telling me not to use the microwave because I messed up. They're telling me not to eat the cat food and the dog food because everything, I don't know if you ever lived abroad, but to me, I'm like, why do you have food for the cats, right? Well, now it makes sense. I've been here almost 5 years now, but I had really been taken, I've been given an orientation. You know, they showed me this side, it's the dog and cat food, okay? You can open the fridge, do you eat pork? I'm like, nope. But you can eat anything else in here. It's like, how do you know a pork from beef? Like, read, Abdi, read. So it was kind of interesting, you know, really. I have messed a lot. The microwave, I left a cup of tea for like 2 hours there. I don't know. I was hoping the thing to stop, but didn't happen. They put me behind the wheel. I crashed the garage and all this. But that had really strengthened our relationship. I have become the force of the house. I chopped wood for winter. I piled them up. I like to do things outdoors. And I would be up in the woods clearing things. You know, I take care of the chickens. I collect eggs and do something with the eggs. I cook, you know, out of the eggs. And anyways, I've really become a Mainer. My first job was insulation. I made $11 an hour. That was great. You know, I was happy, I wasn't complaining. Okay, so anyways, these days I published a memoir, and this memoir is becoming a film. Actually, several filmmakers have approached us, but you know, my agent takes care of that. I sometimes feel like, can we have Arnold Schwarzenegger in here? Can we have Eddie Murphy play me? You know, I just have all these childhood creations, but it's interesting. It's me. I'm not disconnected from my childhood. So so that's one thing. Maine has almost 30,000 refugees and immigrants and asylum seekers together. Nowadays, we have 300 asylum seekers from two African countries. I don't know if you're following the news. Portland has taken Congolese and Angola refugees, asylum seekers, that crossed the Mexican border, and Texas wouldn't keep them, so they loaded them up in a bus. They have arrived all the way to Portland. We don't have a place to put them. And I have been deeply involved and volunteered with, like, now the main problem is housing. And Maine does not really have a good housing. And the immigrants don't, asylum seekers don't want to go outside of Portland, because outside of Portland, it's pretty much empty. You know, nobody wants to live in a farmhouse where there's no bus service, where there's no even, you can't even call Uber. It's pretty much up in the woods. So Portland has a deadline for August 15 for 300 people to be housed, and it's crisis. It's crisis. The mayor's in confusion. We had meetings after meetings after meetings, and it's really not working out. So I'm sort of worried. I see them the same, you know, way I went through, but now I'm like, we're trying to get each family take at least one or two around Portland area. And that's what I do these days. I volunteer when I'm in Maine. I take them to the movie theater. I've now become the McDonald's, you know, when people showed me things. Now I'm taking them to Dunkin' Donuts, and I would say, that is a tea. But they called iced tea. They put ice in the tea. In Africa, we don't know nothing about that. But somehow these Americans figured to turn tea cold. If you ever ask me what tea is, to me, tea is 100% hot. So it comes hot, you can add whatever, sugar or whatever. But here, there's iced tea, and actually they loved it. You know, they tried it. Sort of I can read the menu these days. And so that's what I do. It's becoming a film. We have the young adults version also coming up. And I'm very sure that I just give you a tiny bit of the book, but if you read, you will truly enjoy. You will find in depth what it really means to be an American. You don't have to be American to be here. There are millions out there who are like me, taught themselves English, love America, but now America is building a wall, closing its doors. They have no hope. And groups like Al-Shabaab and ISIS are taking advantage of these young people. They're recruiting them. They're reinforcing, you know, themselves. And now America has really put itself in a place where the enemies are thriving, and America is just facing a bad image in the face of the world. So I'm going to open the questions.
I'm just looking at the time.
Wow. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought I was speaking 20 minutes.
I have my understanding, there's a large community of Somalis in Williston. Mm-hmm. And are they helpful? And also, they're, what you're describing are refugees coming from Angola and Congo. Mm-hmm. Do they coordinate well? Do the different countries' refugees coordinate well together?
Yes.
Get along?
Yes, there are several organizations run by immigrants in Maine. The Congolese community have their own organization, the Somali community have their own organization, and the Kenyans, the Angola. So what's happening is asylum seekers are receiving so much support from immigrant communities that are already based and working and have houses, you know, places to live. But how can we help? Like, what can we do? We can't give them housing. The state of Maine has sort of opened its heart, and we have raised $900,000, almost a million dollars, to just support them. So we're hoping that the city allocates that money in a good way for every single one of those asylum seekers to find a housing. But unfortunately, what is the hope? These asylum seekers came here to receive, to be able to work, receive permanent residence and become American citizens,
unfortunately, the federal government runs that program. So they could be denied or they could be accepted. We don't know. But with what we have now, we don't know what's going to happen with them. But that's what confuses them. They keep asking questions like that. I need a lawyer. I need someone to work with me in my case. With the immigrants in Maine, we don't have good lawyers. So we don't know.